So that's three different directions that it's going, is inflammation, migraine and other nervous system disorders, and anxiety.
Amanita muscaria is a misunderstood mushroom, but we are going to try to change that with this relatively unstructured discussion and definitely atypical Stone Age Man video here today. I hope you enjoy this chat, but before I get into it, let me start with why I think this is important. And it all stems from the one misconception that it seems most people have.
Look, but don't touch. And that makes me sad. Because if there's anything the world needs to be touching right now, it's this mushroom and getting familiar with it. And not calling it and framing it around its toxicity. Because we don't do that with chicken. If you don't cook chicken, it can make you sick. Yeah. And if you down a whole bottle of your medication, it could kill you. But this mushroom, you just prepare it properly and it could be the best medicine that the world needs.
If you know a lot about my channel, then you know that one of my big things is to teach people to get out in nature and not be afraid of it. Mother Nature is not trying to kill you. Even something that is considered toxic, right? I eat a lot of toxic things on this channel, is really all about the dosage.
Toxin is in the dose. Everything is deadly in the right dose.
Right. I can give you a bottle of aspirin, and if you eat that whole bottle of aspirin, you're gonna be in big, big trouble, but a little bit of it is actually good for you. So if we know just little bits, we're gonna be so much better. And this mushroom highlights that point so well. Now, I make sure I share the best information I can on this channel and through the videos. And that's why I feel like it's really important to get the rest of this information out, because it is misconceptions that even I had when I started. When I made this video a month ago and found the Amanita in the woods, this is what I started with.
I don't like having a messed up liver.
And look, that's how we all learned. Jonas said the same thing.
Although you cannot pick it and you should never eat it.
It wasn't until I did a deep dive into this mushroom and scoured the internet to try to figure out everything I could about it that I realized I was wrong. I shouldn't have started the video that way, and thank goodness I didn't include it in the final version.
Amanita muscaria are my favorite ones. Look how cool this is.
And that's what led me to Amanita Dreamer. Her story is complex.
Well, it saved my life, and I mean that literally. I have to be honest.
I would consider her one of the experts on the topic. And by chance, we both live on the East Coast, so we met up in the mountains of North Carolina to talk through this mushroom and get to know it better.
So I'm pretty excited to learn what I can and just dive into this mushroom. I really feel we are in a mushroom revolution right at the moment. We are learning the health benefits of everything from lion's mane to psilocybin mushrooms. I was always curious though, why was it that we don't use Amanita muscaria very much? It has very well-documented cultural uses that go back thousands and thousands of years. And yet, I couldn't hardly find anybody that uses it. So I wanted to ask Amanita Dreamer specifically about this to get things started.
And this one's just sort of the last one to come on board because of some mistakes that were made about 100 years ago. That's the only death that everyone talks about.
She's talking about Count Achilles De Vecchi, an Italian diplomat residing in Washington, D.C. in 1897, who got a big batch of mushrooms from a random guy at the market, made a soup, and died from it. The death was attributed to Amanita muscaria, and the warnings were spread by mushroom clubs across the country. Decades later, and with modern science, we learned that amatoxins produced the type of death we saw in the count, meaning there must have been another mushroom in the batch.
But they believe that mixed in there was one of the deadly ones.
Quick mushroom lesson here. These deadly ones have amatoxins. They destroy your liver. Fly agarics do not. Yet, this apprehension for the fly agaric remains in our culture today, which is why Amanita Dreamer is trying to change all of that. She wants us to better understand the two main compounds that are in it, ibotenic acid and muscimol.
The ibotenic acid, people say it's the more toxic. But more toxic, I think what people are saying is, can start to cause distress in smaller doses. But I don't believe it's any more toxic than muscimol. So the ibotenic acid is sort of the up side of the mushroom. It increases visual acuity and blood, you know, to the muscles, and increases the nervous system, moves things in the upward direction. So too much of it hits those acetylcholine pathways and can send you over into seizures, right? That's the top end when you get too excitable. So that's not fun. Gastric distress, you know, and right. throwing up because it follows the toxic pathways to get cleaned out of the body. But muscimol, I mean, it's no small thing either. And that's the downside. It hits those GABA receptors the same way that the benzodiazepine drugs do. So it's the turn the volume down deliriant side of this thing. I think because muscimol is more forgiving.
Right.
You can, if you do your conversion, ibotenic acid and muscimol, and you can do a full conversion and take just the muscimol, it's much more forgiving in dose before you reach levels that are unpleasant.
The chemistry of this mushroom to me seems to be one of the biggest problems. I'm a scientist. I like to know exactly what is in things. But here you have a cap. And in that cap, you have ibotenic acid and muscimol, and those two things act differently on the brain. How are you going to know what is in any one cap, especially with the variety out there?
There's no statement you can make about how strong any muscaroid is, other than you don't know, and it varies widely. And people say, aren't the European ones stronger? And there's no, you can't make those statements about them. They are elusive that way, and that's kind of why I like them.
One of the things I noticed is there is a lot of variation in the color of these dried caps.
So these ones right here are the persicinas. You can see how different they are. See that?
Those are the local from here.
Yeah, those are the ones that are from my area. And then these are muscarias. These two are Siberian, and these are Russian. So the Russian ones this year are very more gold red-ish, which tends to be a little further south. They tend to be a little more gold red. But more often than not, the Siberians are just in your face red. Like, they're just red.
Now, I always had the understanding that this might not be a medicine that the average person would take. This is a shaman's medicine. But I asked her, who does she think would benefit from this medicine?
In today's society, everybody.
Yeah.
It's such a toxic society. We're all so afraid. We're all strung out. We're living on a time that is hard. We don't live by nature time or earth time. We live by clock time, and it's rush, rush to survive. There's a lot of doom and gloom and fear everywhere. I don't know anyone that's not struggling with anxiety. And there's so many hidden forms of anxiety and, you know, agitation and inability to sleep and feeling itchy, feeling nervous, feeling frustrated, being quick to anger, negative thoughts, negative outcomes, and putting negative spins on things. Like this, we're not supposed to live like that as humans. That's anxiety. And it's warranted, but it's not necessary. I don't know anyone that doesn't need it, but in a more severe way, I would think people that are struggling with so much anxiety, they can't function. People that are really distracted and can't focus and they need to. And neurodiverse people, like I'm autistic, and then there's ADD people. We're not broken. We just don't function the way society wants us to function or that we need to function to be able to put a roof over our heads and food in our mouth. And this mushroom really alleviates a lot of that, the way that we need to live but not lose our sense of self and our identity and our neurodiversity that's good for the planet. And it's helped me find a way to navigate the world through my neurodiversity, still be me, but not with the anxiety anymore.
At this stage, I was just wondering, why isn't it that we don't just convert all the ibotenic acid to muscimol? Why have this mix?
Well, it depends on what you're after and why you're taking it. And when I was coming off of benzodiazepines, I needed muscimol. I didn't need anything up. I just needed that muscimol. And it turns out I did the research right and I converted it enough that I got that. But it depends on what you're trying to do. If you're trying to treat your attention, if you're trying to problem solve, if you want focus, then you would want some ibotenic acid. But if you want to have sort of a spiritual experience with this and take like a heroic dose, to me, the wisdom is in the mushroom to tell you what you need. And it's the ibotenic acid that gives you that sense of joy and beauty and wonder and peace. It brings you into the lessons gently before it slowly says, okay, you're doing good. Come on, let me introduce you to my friend. And then the muscimol takes over and it's like, we need to talk. And that's when the lessons come.
Now, I'm not advocating in any way to use Amanita muscaria. I think that would be a problem because we don't know a whole lot about it, it seems. But here you have Amanita Dreamer, who talks about it on her website, amanitadreamer.net. She has some products that she sells. She seems to say that it is very useful for her. But this brought me to my big question, which is, what does science tell us about this mushroom and the traditional uses of it?
Well, we use the lore to sort of give us information about where we can go with the science, you know? But the science is the thing to look at. That's how we know what's safe to do and safe to use. The more I read the lore and traditional use, the more I know that that's actually where we need to be going with this. I am a scientist, and before I can tell you something definitively, I'm going to look at the science first. Otherwise, I'm going to preface it with, this is simply anecdotal information. This is what the lore says, or traditional use says.
She's talking here about the fact that one traditional use is to make fat-soluble compounds out of them. She's been exploring a lot of this herself, and just this week, a company out of Canada tested these compounds and found that these extracts can inhibit human connective tissue mast cell activation. In other words, it helps with inflammation. But the science doesn't stop there.
There's a corporation right now doing human clinical trials to, first of all, get it designated as safe for human consumption. The FDA has to say that. And then their second round of clinical trials are going to be for anxiety, PTSD, that kind of thing, which I know that they'll get that. We don't know 100%, but I feel confident in their ability to get that. So that's three different directions that it's going, is inflammation, migraine and other nervous system disorders, and anxiety. I believe that this will be an equally complex medicine, if not more complex, and have many layers to it, not just ibotenic acid and muscimol. And it will have many methods of delivery, and it will work on many different parts of the body, including the endocannabinoid system, because there's crossover there. I just don't know what it is. So I want science, and there's very little.
Thanks, everybody, for watching that short. I have to give a big thank you to Amanita Dreamer, who you can find out more about at amanitadreamer.net. She has a whole bunch of videos that talk about how she uses and has discovered this mushroom herself. You can also watch the extended interview on my Patreon, which I think some of you may find very fascinating. I just feel like maybe this isn't the place to put that because I wanted to keep things condensed here. And by supporting my Patreon at a couple dollars a month, you support this outreach that I'm trying to do, basically diving into topics that are not well understood, but could really give us tremendous value. So I thank all my patrons who are there already. Thank you for diving into this channel with me, and hopefully we'll see you in the next one very soon.
Could be like, here's how to maybe start. Not going to worry about this being on camera necessarily, but...
This should be on camera.
Yeah.
Like, this should be on camera. You should start